I'd like to welcome Megan Alpert, who is also a poet lore contributor and our featured poet tonight. Megan, if you just wanted to unmute and give everyone a brief introduction about yourself, your wonderful book, The Animal at Your Side, which we'll be talking about, and if you wouldn't mind reading a poem or two to get us started.
Sure. Can you all hear me okay? Is this an okay distance from the computer? Okay, cool, thanks. So thank you so much, Emily. Congratulations on the editorship. Also, it might be old news at this point, but it feels new to me. So my name is Megan Alpert. I have been writing poetry for a long time. I've never had to introduce myself before. So let's see. I grew up in New York. I lived in the DC area for about 3 years, during which time I was actually, for the most part, taking a break from poetry. I left poetry for a little while to work on nonfiction and journalism. And so that's something that we might talk about later. This is my book. It's my first book. Took a long time to get it out there. So I'm halfway through a second book at this point. And I love the world of DC literary life. And something that was really, that just like opened my world as a poet and made me into more of a performer. And really gave me a beautiful community. So how's that for an introduction?
Great.
Okay. Thank you. All right, so I'm gonna read, I wanted to read two poems from the book because there's some different sort of voices in it. And so I'm gonna read one that's in a more childhood voice and one that I think of as a more fully grown up voice. So this first poem is called Unsettled. My friend and I went to the lake, found a skull and took it home. Washed it, set it out to dry on the shed roof in the sun. Still, my mother saw it, shuddered. We buried it in the backyard underneath the compost heap. Now my dinner tastes like bones. The backyard pile of rotted wood we'd pull apart to see the bugs. We turned a plank into a table. My friend came to and to the house. We made a stew of broken rocks. My parents would not eat the bones or lick the bones or love the bones. We knew that there had been a war, and after that, there was a manor. Then it all became this town. Lenape, Wappinger, and Butlers thundered through and through the woods. Sleepless, scared, we'd dig and listen. Shards of them, the earth churned up. To us, we thought, to us. So thank you. This second poem is called Caught. Outside, the sea chews the rocks to salt. In the room, a crouching extravagance. Spilled silk, a tumbled glass. The shower hums, the room contracts. Whose knuckles are they that rattle in the glass? Who jeweled in the sea through night? Outside, the sea chooses carefully. It does not sink the city. It does not snuff the sun. The old cries bead across the surface of the glass.
Thank you, those were great. And I think a great way to kind of dive into talking about the collection and all the different things that are going on there. I did want to just add before we go into our discussion, please, please, please buy Megan's book. I think the link should be in the chat already, but we'll be posting it again at the end from the publisher or from your local bookseller. Please support her work. And also throughout the chat, if you have questions, put them in the chat box at the bottom of your screen, and we'll try to get to those as well and kind of weave them into the discussion too. So there's a lot of places that I think we could start with talking about this collection. But I wanted to kind of talk about your use of image, which I think was really apparent in the two poems that you just read. Image and sound really came through when you read them aloud. So I'm wondering if you could talk about the importance of image in your work, and you know, how your writing process revolves around incorporating those really vivid images.
Yeah. So I think that I don't, I think that, so I've been thinking a lot about this because I saw your question yesterday, and I think that I don't actually consciously think about image. I think about scene, and there's a wish or a desire to fully get, like, you can never completely get to what it is really, what it's like to be in a certain place in a certain time, but there's a wish to get as close to it as possible. And so I think there's that part of it. But I also, another important thing about this is that I think I'm actually in the process of planning a panel discussion for the Massachusetts Poetry Festival called Poetry as a Visual Art. And I think that there is a way in which, like, poetry can be a lot closer to making a painting or making something out of clay than it is to writing a story or an essay. And when I have done artist residencies in the past, I found, like, a really rich conversations happening with visual artists about our process. And so when you ask about process, it's like, I can't say necessarily, oh, I get an image and I build the poem around it. I think it's always different. Sometimes it's usually there's words, there's sounds, I'm like listening for something. But I would say in terms of the process of making the poem, when I heard artists talk about their work for the first time, it really freed me up to engage with my own work, not as I think poetry is so much taught in schools as if there's like a thesis statement and you're trying to get to the thesis, and whoever like correctly uncovers the thesis is the person who like understands the poem, and then everybody else feels like they don't get it. And I just have so many really smart people tell me that they don't understand poetry. And so what I always want to say is, like, you know, you actually already know how to love poetry if you know how to like listen to a song and love it, if you know how to stand in front of a painting and enjoy that painting. Like, there's ways to encounter art that are not about deducing something. Right. And when I read that poem, Caught, on stage, I often start by saying this poem is a painting, because there's nothing to interpret. Like, people get so self-conscious about, like, if I show them my poetry, thinking that they need to say back to me what the thesis is, and there's no thesis there. It's a visual art in some ways.
Yeah, I wonder how, if that connects to what you're talking about with scene and kind of capturing scene in its most kind of truthful way. And I'm thinking too how that connects to maybe your life as a journalist as well, and how we're taught to write journalism with scenes and use all the five senses and things like that. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the intersection between that type of writing and your poetry.
Yeah. Well, so I started writing poetry when I was 13. So it's kind of one of those things where, so I used to be a reading tutor. And when I was trained, one of the questions they asked us was, do you remember learning how to read? And a lot of people said, no, I don't remember that. And I was one of them. And they said, well, that's because it was easy for you. And if it had been challenging, you would remember it. So I think about that a lot when people ask me questions about poetry, because I sort of started it. It just kind of was my language. And so I don't, in some ways, like I don't always have answers. With journalism, I very much remember learning how to be a journalist. I did it in my 30s. It did not come naturally to me. It was very scary. I was very intimidated by trying to get things right. So I would say that the part of writing journalism where you're making scenes and where you're trying to get the person there's this added difficulty to it, which is that it's not just about conveying an emotional truth. It's like really the true truth. Like, do you really remember what color this person's sweatpants were? And, you know, which hill were you standing on when such and such happened? And so there's a whole other weight to it. I think having been a writer for all those years definitely helped me as a journalist, but I used to go around saying nonfiction is the hardest genre because there's so much responsibility there. And now that I've been a journalist, I see that it's also there in poetry for sure.
Yeah, that's interesting. I have a journalism background, and I'm in a journalism class right now in my MFA program. And yeah, you really feel that pressure to get everything right and everything exact. And there's no leeway when it comes to memory and shifting memory, and which is something you really embrace in poetry and even other forms of creative writing, that kind of malleability. Oh, we have a question in the chat. Maybe I'll loop this in since we're still kind of on this subject. From Ron, you mentioned poetry coming to you easily as your language. Did something inspire you toward poetry in your early teens?
Yeah, so I think part of it is just being, being a highly sensitive person that feels every emotion like times 100. That is a big part of it. And also when I was, I think probably 11 or 12, my parents bought me a collection of Edna St. Vincent Millay. And I would just like read that thing like every night. And I would memorize the poems, and I really identified with, I mean, Millay is just so, she's so into her emotions and she's so into nature and she cares so much. And I just kind of ingested it, it felt like. And then a few years later, I did the same thing with like Nikki Giovanni's work. So I think part of it was having those mentors through books. I also, when I was 13, we did a poetry unit in school that was, honestly, I don't remember what they actually taught us. I just remember them being like, write a lot of poems. And so the first time I ever did anything in front of a class, the first time that I was like special in any way was when I read a poem to my class. And I just was kind of like, this is it. Like, this is my life's work. I'm 13 years old and I've decided. And I am gonna be very serious about this, and I'm gonna fill up notebooks, and I'm gonna just like read the hell out of, like, I don't know, I had poems like hanging on my wall. And it wasn't even that I read widely, I just read, you know, Edna St. Vincent Millay and Nikki Giovanni like really deeply. So yeah.
Yeah, that's great. That's really great. It is always fun to kind of look back on those inspiring moments that triggered something in kind of helping get you to where you are and looking back on those tendencies to turn maybe towards those same influences at a later date and things like that. I wanted to circle back to kind of that idea of truth, because there's an interesting moment in the notes at the end of the book where you wrote some of the poems are true and some feel true. And that really resonated with me in thinking about how to present things that, you know, are of one experience and there's other people involved and things like that. So I wonder if you could just talk about, you know, that kind of emotional truth that we've been kind of discussing in some of our questions. You know, how do you go about sort of excavating that emotional truth and keeping that in a poem while still, you know, creating the space of the poem for the poem to breathe outside of the lived experience?
Yeah. So it this question makes me kind of go in a couple different directions. One, one of my big fears when I published this book was that people would assume things about my family that are not true. And I felt like I think if you read the book, you can see that the narrators are kind of going through a series of like sort of transformations and that it's very lyric and it's not necessarily telling a true story. But I really wanted to say that because I just thought it was important. And I mean, I think almost none of the there's like four or five poems in the book that are like factual, like from start to finish. And a lot of that comes from the fact that the truth is really hard to say. And that, you know, the truth of my lived experience with my family, with leaving home, I was estranged from my family for quite a while. I don't know how to explain that in normal words. Right. And so I think, you know, I don't have the language available to me that can fully describe like why this happened and what it was like. So, you know, I have these stories. And so that's the case for many of the poems, but then there are a couple poems. So all the poems that take place in Ecuador are true. And part of that is that I was writing them when I was a little bit older. And part of it is that a couple of them are about other people's lives and they're about journalism that I was doing. And for those, I don't feel like I have that kind of license to say, oh, this is what feels true to me. I mean, that's something you can do with your own life experience. But for those, it was like, nope, can't embellish, can't make things up. Like these are real people. So the rules of journalism apply.
Right.
Did I fully answer your question? I feel like
That's great. I mean, I think it's always difficult to kind of put these things into words anyways, because, you know, sometimes what gets you starting the poem is that factual scene of what happened, but throughout the editing process to really help the poem be realized, some of that falls away. At least I've noticed that in workshops with younger poets, they're like, this is what happened. And it's like, well, that doesn't need to be what happens in the poem if it's, you know, your experience. But I appreciate how you're kind of delineating between, it's almost like an ethics question with other people's stories and other information where maybe you were an observer or an outsider perspective.
Yeah, and I also actually, I wanted to talk about one other kind of example, which is that there was a poem that I took out of the book, and I took it out because I didn't feel like it was ethical. And it's a poem that I published it before I became a journalist. And I think that, I wish that people would talk about this more, because in my MFA, the guidance that I got was basically, the guidance in terms of writing about other people was basically, if you didn't want me to write about you, you should have acted better. Mm. And that's just like a really limited worldview, and a really limited way to decide how to do something that can have consequences, emotional and otherwise, for other people. So, you know, I did publish a poem in my earlier years that I feel like was not 100% ethical, in that I was trying to convey the truth of a friendship, a really intense friendship I had in college. And what I set out to write a poem about how much I loved this person, and it ended up kind of as a poem about like how messed up this person was. Mm-hmm. And it didn't feel true, but it was a really good poem. Like, it was one of my best poems. And so in a writing workshop that I had, two poet friends of mine were like, this is just great as it is. Like, don't worry about those feelings of like loving this person and being loved by this person that you want to convey. Like, you can put that in a different poem. Mm. But I think like probably a year after it was published, I was like falling asleep one night, and I just was like, oh my God, like that was so wrong. Mm-hmm. And the other guidance I got in my MFA was basically like, don't worry too much about what you're going to publish, because like no one you know is going to read it. Like, nobody really reads literary magazines. Mm. Well, then suddenly all the literary magazines were on the internet. And I think people probably are going to read what you write. So that kind of safety valve, I mean, first of all, that's not even a good way to think about it, because if you publish a book, like everyone who's close to you is going to read it. Right. But second of all, like, it is likely that that person read that poem and was probably hurt by it. And that's terrible. So I do wish that there were more, and maybe there are now, I got my MFA kind of a while ago. So maybe there are more complex conversations happening about this now. But I sort of just wanted to talk about that as like, you can't just always get away with being like, well, it feels true, you know, because mm-hmm. sometimes it's just not, or sometimes it doesn't even feel true.
Right, right. Yeah, there is a way that I think that, you know, statement, well, no one's really going to read it because who reads literary magazines? There's a way that now you can't really use that anymore. I know I've published some things that I feel really good about, but I would prefer my family not to find, but you know, they're on the internet, they're going to find it and bring it up at family dinners or whatnot. And so, yeah, I think that, you know, it's important to think about an audience that is kind of greater than your own bubble or your own pen and paper even. Mm-hmm. And it's also important to talk about, you know, what maybe doesn't make it into the book, or you know, wrestling with those decisions. So I wondered about shifting a little bit to talking about the construction of the book for you. I know you mentioned that it happened over a long span of time. So, you know, what was that like? How did you kind of put these poems in their sections? You have five sections in the book that kind of weave some threads throughout the poem. So I wonder if you could just talk about that process.
Yeah, so I was very, very intentional in the way that I structured the book. And I did a lot of reading of poetry collections where I was reading not just individual poems, but reading to see the shape of the whole thing. And one that I really want to recommend is, you can get the restored edition of Sylvia Plath's Ariel. So her original order, and you can see the difference. She referred to it as a book that starts with the word love and ends with the word spring. which is very different from what was actually published after she passed away. So in shaping the book, I had seen the way a lot of writers divide their books into sections where it's sort of like thematic. Here's family, here's love, here's some political stuff. I didn't want to do that. And I also didn't want to have a narrative arc that was sort of like, and then I was healed. And then everything was fine. I wanted to have it be more complicated than that and to be kind of shifting always, because that's how I felt like my life was going. Like, so I decided to divide it by landscape. And so all of the poems in the first section are in the woods. And I should say also that I started with like a big pile of stuff, basically, because I'd been writing for a while when I decided to put this book together. And so I had these papers and I was like on the floor. I did this at Vermont Studio Center. I was like on the floor with my papers and I was taping them to the wall and everything. And once I divided them by landscape, there were thematic links in the poems that were in different landscapes. So it was like in the woods, by bodies of water, inside houses. And then the fourth section was always this weird, like going outwards again, traveling far away. And then the fifth section is all in a bed in the dark. I wish I could tell you exactly why. All I know is that I started with that, and that has always been the structure of the book since I first put it together 10 years ago.
Wow.
And that in that time, about a third of the book has like been taken out and changed. I mean, there's so many poems that are not in this book that were in the beginning, but somehow that structure has always been what the book is. And I think there's something about the themes of the book, the going home and leaving and returning and like, you know, finding something far away from home, that just, that structure works, and it allows for there to not be the kind of arc that I didn't want to have. I didn't want it to be, I left home, and then I traveled far away, and then I fixed all my problems, and then I went back, and everything was, like, I really wanted to resist that.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And I'm wondering if you could talk about, since this book was kind of under construction for so long, you know, was it started as an MFA thesis? How did that kind of transform? I think, you know, we put a lot of pressure on MFA theses to like be the book, but a lot of times they're just kind of the first stepping stone to the book. So I'm curious about that for you.
Yeah, my MFA thesis was not the book. And it was structured really differently. I tried to structure it similarly to Ariel. It was all in one section. And there were all these poems about things being buried and things being unearthed. And I wanted that to be kind of an arc through the book of like things coming up out of the earth after being buried. And I don't know, it just wasn't it. And I never even sent that version of the book out. Maybe it also would have been a fine book. I don't know. To be honest, like I didn't start really. So I got my MFA, I guess, in 2007. And I would say I didn't actually start doing the things that you need to do to be a working poet until probably 2010 or 2011. Like I put together this book because I was at a writing residency and the visiting rec, I said, I'm gonna make a chapbook because a book seemed too scary. And the visiting writer was like, it's just as hard to make a whole book as it is to make a chapbook. Like, why don't you just do that if you're gonna spend your energy on this? And I was like, okay. So it took a long time to get the book published and out, but I also I feel like I didn't really start trying until I was 30, as much as I had been writing for so long. So start trying. That's my advice.
No, that's great. Greg has a question about how you ended up with Airlie Press, and that was going to be my next question. You know, what was that submission process like for you? I know this was also a finalist for the National Poetry Series and kind of things like that. So just if you could talk a little bit about that submission process.
Yeah, so I think my submission process might be instructive. So I started sending it out in probably 2012 or 2013. It was the first year I sent it out, it was a finalist for the Saturnalia Prize. And I had an editor at another press send me a personal note saying, basically, I almost chose it. I almost chose this. So that was either 2012 or 2013. And I thought, I'm all set. Like, this will happen any day now. And then 6 or 7 years went by. So I don't know. I mean, I didn't track my submissions. I found it too depressing. The year after I got that finalist nod, I sent it out to I think I spent probably $300 sending my book out to different contests. I hope that the poetry world has a reckoning with contest fees at some point, because I think we're probably missing out on a lot of people's work who can't afford those fees. But it just didn't, I don't know. I mean, I was a finalist again in Saturnalia the next year. And it just didn't happen. I don't know. And then I did have a poet friend, Sarah Blake. She helped me do a revision in, I think, 2015 or 2016. And then that was the year that it was a finalist for the National Poetry Series. And I think it's just it's so hit or miss. You could get these finalist things forever, potentially. Yeah. I mean, it's wonderful. It's great encouragement, but it's very much shooting in the dark. Like, if you don't hit the target, you still haven't hit the target, even if you came close. And so I definitely started revising my list of places to send it down over the years, because I just didn't want to keep dumping my money into contest fees.
Right.
And I don't know. I didn't send it to Airlie thinking it would get picked up. It wasn't like I chose that press. They chose me. And I was so shocked when they emailed me. I would say the really great thing about Airlie that I appreciate is that they don't tell the finalists. That week or two when you know you're a finalist and you're waiting to see if you're going to get picked is kind of hell. And so I didn't get an email saying I was a finalist. I just got an email one day saying hey, we want to publish your book. And I immediately got very nauseous, because it was something that I had stopped thinking was going to happen. And I guess I would say, I think what I learned from this process too was just how to enjoy life as a writer without a book. I think that's a pretty important skill, because it's a long haul to publish a poetry book, no matter how great your poetry is. So when I moved to DC, I started doing a lot of readings, and that just felt wonderful. Because you're just immediately sharing your work with people and they're responding to it. I collaborated. So the artist that did the book cover, or the painting that's on the book cover, is a friend of mine. Oh, and wow. She and I collaborated on a series of broadsides that I should have brought them out so I could show you. But having the broadsides was okay, now at a reading, I could potentially sell something. And I have this object that a lot of them just ended up being given as gifts. but yeah, just like finding ways to do stuff on your own that like feels good, I think is really important. And like, just, I wish I hadn't been so tortured by the process. Like, if you don't have a book out yet, you just don't have a book out yet. You're still a writer, you're still a poet. And I don't know, it's, I guess, yeah, having like full respect for yourself and your work, even during that really tough time, is like really important.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And it's that sense of community is sustaining that you get at readings, especially reading series. DC has such a vibrant reading scene, which is so lovely. And I think often overlooked in favor of, you know, other things that are happening in the city. But I know that that's been something that's really given me a personal boost as well. Marcella's wondering if you were only submitting to contests or if there were other open calls for submissions just with different presses and things like that.
Yeah, so I think like three or four years into the process, I started looking for low cost ways to get my book out. And I did start querying different editors, and that felt better. I had some interest from one press and kind of exchanged emails with this editor over the course of like a year or two, ultimately I wrote to her and was able to say like actually got picked up. But yeah, I think querying is good. I just think building up your sense of community in general is like a really, really, really good thing, because, and not in a way where you're like, hey, what can I get out of this?
Right.
But really, like, that's the thing about being a writer that is great, is like, you are part of this world of amazing people who are choosing to do this kind of insane thing of making art. And so like, it does open doors for you to have those friendships. And I think, you know, having been so long without a book, because my book was published so late, and because I kind of started to just make the best of it and just be grateful for like the community and the people in my life, now I feel like I have all these people in my corner that are really excited about my book. And I didn't go into those friendships like, how is this going to help me? I went into those friendships because those people were interesting and they were making cool work and I love talking to them. So yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. And it's getting some huzzas in the chat as well. Some exclamations there. I'm wondering too, in that period where you were continually kind of working on the book, were you also, I mean, I'm sure you were, you know, submitting individual poems to different literary magazines and stuff. If you could talk about that aspect of it as well as you went with this book.
Yes. So again, in my 20s, I would say my method of submission was like, send out 5 poems, wait anxiously, get rejected, feel terrible, or, you know, get an acceptance and be like, ah, my career has started. You know, it's just like everything that happened had so much weight. Right. And so a couple years ago, somebody in a writing group that I'm part of started this thing that she called the 100 Rejections Club. And this changed my whole outlook and my whole life. And it was just basically like, try to get 100 rejections. So I did it for 2 years. I think I got 50 or 60 some rejections the first year, and I got 70 rejections the second year. And then this past year, I've gotten no rejections because I haven't been sending out work. But it's like a Pavlovian thing. Like, I started to, like, I would get an email and be like, ooh, I'm getting closer to my goal. You know, like, I wasn't even, I don't know, that whole aspect of it, of sort of like, this is gonna make or break me, what this one email says, was just gone. And it was like, I'm accomplishing this task. And this year, I think I had like 6 poems published this year, which is kind of a record for me. And it's because of those 2 years that I spent like just submitting the hell out of everything. And I just like, I had a poem that was published last year that was nominated for Best of the Net. And it had previously, it's in this book also. And it had previously been rejected 20 times.
Wow.
And I had a poem come out this year. I believe one of the poems that just came out in Copernickel, which was like one of my goal magazines, has been rejected 20 times. So like that more than anything else just showed me that like rejections don't mean anything. I mean, I just like, and even when you look at the different, I mean, because there's ways to kind of rank literary magazines based on, you know, what gets picked up in Best American or things like that. And I have poems that have been rejected by all the literary magazines that don't make it on those like top 100 lists, and then accepted by one that is on that top 100 list. So I just think like, make a game of it, you know?
Yeah, when you were saying, you know, that you had 50 rejections that one year and maybe 70 the next, my instinct was to say congratulations, because you're, you know, you're getting towards your goal, but then you kind of walk that back and say, well, it's rejection. But I think that is really important, especially thinking about how many literary magazines have rotating staff, rotating readers. You really never know who's looking at it at what time. At what time they're reading the submissions. Is it the first submission of the day? Is it the 100th submission of the day?
Is it right before lunch? Are they really hungry? Did they just have a bad phone call with their mother?
Right.
Yeah. And also, you know, the other thing about that is like, now having been, having reached a certain age where I've like been in this world for a while, I also want to say that when I was first sending out these poems, like, this was not what was popular in the sort of mid late 2000s. Like, the kind of poetry I was writing was just like way out of favor. What was getting published and what was like hot was like super highly ironic, very like removed voice. It was not like, I'm feeling an intense emotion and I'm 100% serious about it. Like, that was out. So that's come back around, and now lyric poetry is more popular. People are really into emotions and images and stuff like that. But it's kind of like, I think I learned a lot from writing the wrong kind of poetry for a long time. And there was a certain time when I was like, I just got to figure out how to be funny. And I tried so hard, and I'm not good at it on the, you know, on the page. And I wrote poems that I didn't really believe in, that I sort of hoped would get me a foot in the door, and that kind of made me hate writing, and that weren't authentic. So, I mean, I think the other piece of it too is like, whatever you're writing, like it might just not be popular right now, but it might be popular in 5 years.
Right, and always, you know, staying true to that voice and staying true to your personal style and writing the work that you believe in, I think is so important too.
Yeah.
And it pays off. It might just take a while, but it pays off. I wanted to circle back to talk a little bit about some of the themes in the book, because we kind of mentioned, you know, this structure of landscape, but there's so many places in the book, and there's so much emphasis on what is home, what does it mean to be in a place that maybe feels like home at one point, but then over time shifts and things like that. So I wonder if you could talk about those themes and how you kind of structured them throughout the book and use the different places, the locations of the poems to kind of, you know, draw those themes out in a way.
Yeah, So I think that there's some questions that the book is asking about home. And one of them is like, how do you make a home? How do you know when you're home? And like, what do you do when like the idea of home has been kind of, has been complicated for you? And when you've sort of lost this sort of foundation that other people maybe seem to have. So I would say that like a lot of the poems are sort of like, is this it? Is this it? And that sometimes that gets tied up with the idea of place as well. So sometimes it's like, if I go to this place, is that gonna work? And sometimes it's like, what about with this person? Like, will this work? And so I think the poems are kind of asking those questions and sort of trying to answer in different ways. And also kind of like, well, what if I just like forget this idea of home altogether? And like, what if I go really, really far away? So I don't think it's a question that gets answered. And I also don't, I mean, it was funny when I read this question of yours, I sort of felt like, oh, this person like really sees me like too much. But I don't think it's a question I'm asking on purpose. Right. I think it's a question that you can also kind of see in my life and my career of like having had, you know, I think I've worked in three or four different fields at this point. And also I've lived in several cities and countries. And I don't think there's anything really necessarily bad about that search. Like it's led me to a lot of interesting things. And I think like maybe the poems are kind of some of the like, I don't know, some of what got produced along the way.
No, that's great. There is a way that I think this book is asking a lot of questions, and I think that the structure that you've put it in, you know, it enables those questions to really sit and resonate with a reader rather than, like you said, kind of forcing a narrative or forcing an answer or a plot line to come through. And there's different speakers and things like that, which really, really pop in the poems themselves. I did want to do like a last call for questions in the chat, since we have about eight more minutes here, if anyone has some burning questions here. But if not, I can go back to my question page. And let me see here, let me scroll around.
There's a question from Sierra here.
Oh yeah, oh, I missed that one. Oh yeah, when did you really start sending out and sharing your poetry? And how does it feel to go back and read work from before? That's a good question.
So I would say I started getting serious when I was 30, and I'm 40 now. And the thing that made me get serious was I went to Vermont Studio Center and Forrest Gander was a visiting writer, and he was like, you need to get serious. and I had a conversation with my friend Kevin McClellan, who similarly was like, if you want to do the things that you say you want to do, like you have to get serious. And what they meant by that was you need to find people whose work you love, who you can be friends with. You need to publish in journals. You need to write to people whose work that you like, and tell them that you like it. You need to take classes, even just as a way to like have community. You need to have a writing group. Because I was just sort of, I mean, I did my MFA and that was wonderful. But other than that, I was kind of on my own. So yeah, I was 30 and that was 10 years ago. And I wonder like where, you know, I don't regret that, like, but I am kind of like, wow, where would I be if I had started at 20? Cause all these younger poets now are like at 20, they're like, hey, I got my first publication in such and such a really prestigious journal and it's amazing. But the other part of the question was going back and reading work from when I was young. So I don't do that too often, but I have poems memorized that I wrote when I was 13. And I think they're adorable. Yeah, I mean, there's times that I went through that were really hard that I wrote poems about that are like hard to read. But I mean, I don't know, stuff sticks in my brain. So like, if you wanted to hear an Anna St. Vincent Millay poem, I could probably tell you one right now. And that's true for my own poetry as well. But I don't like go back to my old work and like get mad about it or like torture myself about it. I think it's really important to like love the person that you were, as imperfect as they might have been.
Yeah. Yeah. And all of that work is not only a stepping stone to where you are now, but it's that foundation and even going back and maybe not admiring some of the lines themselves or the content. It's still, you know, being able to recognize that for the poet you were at that age was important, I think is part of that driving force to keep going forward, knowing that you can always kind of look back and see. And that kind of leads to Marcella's question, which is, how do you find inspiration to keep writing fresh things? I think this is everyone's question right now. And I know you said you're working on another book, so maybe if you wanted to tie it into that too.
Well, there's always one thing you can count on in life is suffering and grief and inexplicable things. Which is not to say that those are the only things worth writing about. They're not. But I think that the part of me that just like wants to understand what's happening and why is often going to produce poetry. So, you know, I came back to poetry because around the time of the 2016 election, I had a very brief relationship with somebody who really loved poetry. And we would like just say poems to each other. And it brought me back to poetry. And then losing that person brought me back because like, what do I do with grief? Like I make art about it. And there was also something really horrible happening, which was the 2016 election. So, I was like, I'm gonna solve this problem through my next book. And the book has transformed a lot over the past 4 years, but I would say like, find the thing that you're like, I don't get this and I can't stop thinking about it. And for me with the 2016 election, it was anger. So I started writing poems about anger and just like the idea of home, it was a thing where I was like, what is this emotion? Like, why is this emotion and what is it for? And what do we do with it? I don't know. So, you know, I think sometimes people think, oh, I have to like relate this truth. I have to know this thing. I have to impart my wisdom in this poem. And, you could do it that way, but for me, what propels me is like, I don't get it, like, you know? And I think that book thankfully is hopefully transforming into like, how do you heal? which is a much easier question to, or a much more pleasant question, I guess, to ask. But yeah, I would say, like, what do you not understand, right, about that?
Yeah, that's great. And that's something that I think, that's something I love about these craft chats, is that almost every time I talk to a poet, we mention how we love to write about what we're obsessed with, you know, like what can't we stop thinking about? And I think that, you know, that's kind of what you're getting at. It's that nagging, and maybe almost every poem is circling around it, not necessarily naming it, but it appears nonetheless. And that's what makes a great collection, just like this one. So everyone buy Megan's book, please. We are right at the 6 o'clock mark. So unless anyone has any other questions, and Amy's saying, yes, buy the book, read it, write reviews. Reviews are so important for writers, and it's another way of building community. I think that people forget that is, you know, another way to share your insight about a poet's work, and not just on Goodreads, but, you know, write reviews and submit them. And thank you, Megan, for talking to me today and sharing all of this wisdom with our attendees. And thank you all for spending your Friday evening with us. This has been lovely and enlightening and insightful. So I appreciate your time today.
Thanks, everyone. And thank you, Emily. Your questions are, like, amazing. I loved them. And I just loved being able to talk with all of you. Thanks, everyone, for coming.